Hello everyone, I'm Sahil and welcome back to my channel once again. In this episode, I will be showing you guys my personal financial statement and go through with you line by line how it works to track my finances. At the end, I will also reveal my net worth for the first time on this channel. It will mark the start of my financial journey on YouTube and we will be tracking it every month from now on. Before we start, however, if you're new to my channel and to the finance world, I would highly recommend that you check out the episode 2, which covers the basics of accounting so that it is easier for you to grasp whatever I'll be talking about in this video. If not, let's get it rolling. So after watching my last video, my friends told me that I'll talk a lot about businesses. But why? Why does it matter to us in our personal financial journey? Well, the reason is very simple. To achieve financial freedom, it is very important that we understand how to make money work for us instead of us working for money. How do we do that? By investing. Investing in businesses. Whether we start a business or we get ownership through stocks. Either way, we would have to understand how the financial statements work. I didn't learn accounting at school, so by tracking my own finances in the way these publicly traded businesses do gives me a chance to practice. And also, it helps me to evaluate a company I'm trying to invest in by truly understanding their fundamentals. I always thought that would be a great idea, but always way too lazy to do it. In July this year, however, I finally penned it down. It's still a work in progress, but I feel it's way more than what I actually need at the moment. Before we start, just a disclaimer. All the numbers that you will see are real numbers, and I'm not doing it to boast how much money I have, not like I'm a millionaire or something anyways. I'm sharing this information just to be open and transparent. Personally, I have gained a lot of motivation from the people on the internet who are transparent on these matters, especially about their bad moves and mistakes. Sharing when you're already successful is one thing, but sharing as I go along in this journey without knowing the final outcome, as all of you guys watching this video, I believe would be something different and hope that it will be of some value to you guys. Also, I have linked the Google Sheet template of my financial statements in the description below. To use it, just click on the link, open it up with your own Google Drive, make a copy of this template and save it on your drive. Adjust to your own need and start tracking your finances with me. In my template, I have color-coded the numbers. So the black one are the one that you would have to input. The blue one will auto-formulate and the green ones are the ones that are linked to another tab. That is the easy way though, but I would highly recommend that you just use my template as a reference and make your own statements. That way you'd have a better understanding. Along this episode, if you guys have any questions, feel free to leave it in the comments below. I will try to get back to you as soon as possible. But if all that is covered, let's dig in. Alright guys, let me just orientate you around the screen first. So on the left over here, you see all the different line items. On the top over here, you have all the months that we are accounting for. At the bottom, we have the different statements. And the first one we will be looking at is the income statement. So the income statement itself is divided into four different parts. The first one is the revenue. Revenue is the money that comes to me. Secondly is the COGS. COGS stands for cost of goods sold. So let's say for a business that sells these straps, it will be the cost to manufacture these straps. For my personal expenses, I'm using this segment to record my necessities. Thirdly is the expenses, which for a business covers everything else, all the other operating activities. And for me, it's the luxury spendings I make so I can live without all these expenses. And finally, we have the EBIT. EBIT stands for earnings before tax. The revenue here is further divided into five parts. The first one is the active income, which represents the money I made while actively working. At the moment, I'm doing my internship and I get paid $1,200 for that. I'm also doing a part-time job which paid the rest of what you see over here. Secondly is the dividend which I receive on my investments. October was a particularly good month. And thirdly is the interest income. This is where I put all the interest I earn on my bank deposits and also the cashbacks on my credit card spending. Fourthly is the CPFIS. CPF stands for Central Provident Fund, which is a compulsory savings and pension plan for people in Singapore. It's like 401k, but just compulsory. The money in CPF actually earns interest every year. However, you can also invest a part of this money into other products such as stocks or gold or any other products that are available. So the CPF IS actually just represents the dividend on my CPF investments. Lastly is the other, which is self-explanatory. For the money of October, what you see is the money I made by selling a phone that I got together with a recontract of my mobile phone. Adding all this will give you the total revenue or the income. Next is the COGS and the expenses. The line items here are pretty self-explanatory, but there are some things that are repeated, like food. So under COGS, I record the food court food because that is a necessity. However, if I'm feeling like having a McDonald's meal, then I will put it under the expenses section. As you guys can see, my expenses are super low. That's because I'm living with my parents and generally just freeloading. Also, if you recall the cash and accrual accounting methods from my last episode, in my personal accounting, I use a balance of both. For small expenses, I will just do cash accounting, but for bigger expenses like my school's tuition fee, I will record it with the accrual method. And also, I don't do depreciation and amortization just to keep the things simple. Now, what you see in the middle here is the gross profit, which is the total revenue minus the total COGS, and EBIT here, which is the gross profit minus the total expenses. In October this year, I was able to earn $2,200. Now, here's the interesting thing. If you ask someone how much they earn in a month, they will generally give you their salary. But that's not the earnings that we see over here. That's actually the revenue. Earning is what you're left with after you have paid all your expenses. And this is a very important thing to understand. A company can be earning $1 billion, but if their expenses are $1 billion as well, they are not a good company compared to the one that is just making $1 million, but at the end they're left with $500,000. The same is applicable to us as well. How much revenue you make is not as important as what you're left with at the end of the month. Keeping a part of what you make is actually the first step to financial freedom and the founding stone. At the end of the year, everything would be added up over here. So if you want to account for your taxes after this, you can do so. And after you minus off the taxes, you'll get your net income. And that is all for the income statement. Let's move on to the cash flow statement. The cash flow statement as well is divided into three different segments as we discussed in the previous episode. The first one is the cash flow from operating activities, then we have the investing activities, and then we have the financing activities. For a cash flow statement, you start off with the previous closing balance and then account for all the cash movements in and out. In the end, you will be left with the closing cash balance for that particular month. Let's have a closer look in each segment. So in the cash flow from operating activities, you're basically taking all the non-cash items, any increase in payable, and any other non-operation related income out of the net earnings, and adding any decrease in receivables to the net earnings. The result is that you're left with all the cash that you generated solely from your core business, aka your operating activities. So as you can see here, I'm accounting for the change in inventory. In a business, if you, let's say, sold 10 of these straps, the COGS will account for the cost of manufacturing 10 of these straps. But that doesn't mean that you made these straps in that particular month. So it doesn't really change your cash. But how much inventory was produced this month is what is going to affect your cash. Long story short, just taking the difference in the inventory will give you the effects of it on the cash. In our case, however, it's just useless since we don't really have any COGS. It's here yet again for me to just have a better understanding. If you find it confusing, you can just get rid of it. The second item is increase and decrease in receivables. So if you have more receivables in a particular month as compared to the month before, the difference is the cash that you have still not received. However, it's already accounted in the income statement, hence you have to take it out. The reverse is true for increase in receivables. Now, the next one is payables, and it's completely opposite to the receivables. I'll let you guys figure out why. Then we have the prepaid expenses. If you remember the Netflix example I gave in the previous episode, this is exactly how it shows up in a cash flow statement. Since you paid upfront for a year subscription and the cash that went out was $120, but you only accounted $10 in the income statement for that particular month, you would have to subtract the rest of the $110 from your net incomes for your cash to be right. Next we have is the non-operating incomes. Remember the phone I flipped? That income is not from my core business, hence I would have to take that out as well. Lastly are the non-cash incomes. For me, it's the CPF earnings. So the CPF earnings will go back directly into my CPF account and I can't use this as a cash, and hence it's a non-cash item for me. Next we have is the cash flow from investing activities. This is the sum total of all the investments made in a month and also any gains or losses that you might have. So here's where the cash from flipping my phone will show up. In October, I purchased nearly $8,000 worth of stocks and then made $1,130 from flipping the phone. Next we have is the financing activities. This is where any new loan I take will show up as an increase in cash and any repayments made will show up as a decrease. Money management is just the money that my brother gave me to invest for him. After adding the sum of all these segments to your previous month's cash balance, will give you the new cash balance. So now we're done with the second statement as well. Let's move on to the last one, which is the balance sheet. This sheet also is divided into four parts: the assets, liability, equity, and the supplementary information. Assets are of two types, the tangible asset and intangible asset. Tangible assets are the ones that are physical in nature, and intangible are the ones that are on paper but have a monetary value. Examples of intangible assets are patents, contracts, concessions, or intellectual properties. For our case, it could be maybe your life insurance or your knowledge, your education. However, it's too vague, so I don't really use it in my accounting. But then again, there's another way to divide assets: the current assets and non-current assets. Current assets are like cash and something else that can be easily converted to cash in a short notice. However, non-current assets are the ones that are not accessible in a short notice. Under the current assets, I have cash, my equity investments. For non-current assets, I have CPF, CPF investments, inventory that are like my watches, which I treat like investments, and property, prepaid expenses, receivables, and equipment. Cash is linked from the closing balance of the cash flow statement. So I have $14,800 at the end of October. Equity investment. So if you see the supplementary information, here I have the total equity investment, which I just input from my portfolio tracking app, and then input the CPF investment values. Difference of these two automatically gives me the equity investment, which comes out to be $34,600. Then we have the CPF balance, which is $45,950. CPF investments of $6,000. I do not own any properties, so that is zero. Prepaid expenses are my tuition fees, which in the income statement, I split up into 5 months in a semester. Receivables, you already know. Equipment is my dear bicycle, which I use to make deliveries here. So the total assets come out to be over $100,000 in October. Now the liability. It covers the payables, student loan, the money I invested for my brother, and the remaining cash. Also the dividends that I received on his investments. Total liability at the end of the October was $13,000. And now it's time for the final grade, aka my net worth, and that is $94,777, inching close to the 100k mark. Okay, so that's about it for today. Oh, wait. We are not done yet. There's supplementary information as well. So here I track all the cash that I have at the various places. And I can also use the total from here to compare with the closing balance of the cash flow statement. If these two tally, then I'm sure that I have not made any mistakes in the calculations or inputting any of the expenses or income. Down here, I track all the values of my various assets or inventory. So yeah, this time it's really the end of today's episode. Yet again, if you guys have any questions, just list them down in the comments below. Until the next episode, ciao.